What's up, everybody? It is good to see you. We're gonna get going in a couple minutes. We kind of wanted to. We're early people, man, and so we get this going. And last week we had so much problem with the audio. So thank you for joining again this week, and this is kind of our chance to make sure that the audio is actually functioning correctly, so you can hear more than every third word that I say, or whatever that was like the previous week, and the massive pain that was. Let me turn that down within there. So let me get some of my screen set up here so I'm good to go. If you hopefully you should have your Bible with you, because this is a Bible study, and that seems functional. Tonight, we're going to be going through Matthew chapter 5, and we're going to be looking at the passage of the Beatitudes, which is one of the most famous passages in all the Bible, and I'm really excited to dig into this. Give me just a second. I'm going to get the final stuff set up on my end so I can look at what I need to look at and move through all those pieces. There we go. What time we got? 6:59, my time. Hey, so just so you know this, this is kind of now my for real welcome. You guys are about 90 seconds delay behind where I am in this, so I will, as much as I can, be watching the comments on Facebook and YouTube. This is also going to our live.behope.church page, but I'm not able to access that one as well, or at least I can't watch three streams. So just so you know, throughout this time, I'll be looking at different questions to make sure they're coming in okay, and if there's anything that you've got within there. But I'll kind of, as much as I can, watch through those two on the question side. So let's jump into it. So we kind of started this in light of, man, everything, all the delays and everything, and all the time set aside of saying, man, I just like to make an investment in you, in your understanding of the Bible. And for me personally, I really enjoy this. Like, I love scripture. I love going through the Bible. And so I just thought, man, for me, this will be fun. And if this is beneficial to anyone else, that would be a great thing as well. And so as we talked about this last week, some of you missed this piece because the audio was so terrible. A Bible study is really different from scripture, from preaching. Preaching, the role of preaching is to help you have an encounter with God through what he's revealed in scripture that results in life transformation. The role of a Bible study is really to get a grasp of the text. So every time before I preach a message, it is important that I do the study of the Bible and then write the message out of that. But I liken it to this, where preaching a message is kind of like a first-person view. It's looking through the eyes of something and like going through a journey, where a Bible study is more like a 10,000-foot view. Like, let's get above, let's understand what's going on, and let's grasp all the pieces. So I want to jump into this today, and I see Chris Bailey is on and watching. What is up, Chris? Chris actually messaged me and said, hey, I don't know if we can put in requests for the Bible study, but I'd love to hear some on the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God. And I said, Chris, that sounds fantastic. So inspired by Chris Bailey, that's what we're jumping into tonight. So I want to get into Matthew chapter 5. And we're going to start in verse 1. And what I really want to get into within Matthew chapter 5, we'll kind of make known in just a second. This passage of scripture, the one that we're going to focus on mostly tonight, is referred to as the Beatitudes. And I want to do something a little different within the Beatitudes. Almost every teaching that I've gone through, that I've listened under someone, under the Beatitudes, really looked at the Beatitudes from a perspective of, hey, let's get a grasp, let's get a deep understanding of what's taking place within these teachings of Jesus. And this is what I want to do tonight in our time that's just a little different, is I just want to skim the surface on the Beatitudes. I just want to barely like dip our toe into what these statements mean. But I want to pull back from that and see why Jesus had this teaching to begin with. So instead of putting all our impetus on focusing on what did Jesus teach through the Beatitudes, I want to focus even more on, hey, what was Jesus attempting to accomplish by having this teaching to begin with? So we're going to pick it up in Matthew chapter 5, verse 1, and we're going to stop all the time. And I want to let you know throughout this, man, I would encourage you to take notes. I'd encourage you to take notes all the time. I tell our staff this constantly. I say, hey, taking notes says more about our posture as learners than it does the quality of the speaker. So I'd encourage you to take notes no matter what. But if you feel comfortable with it, I would encourage you to like write in your Bible. Like as things stick out to you, as things are significant to you, this is my Bible. Like I have stuff written all throughout. That way, as I'm reading through it, I don't always have my notes with me. I have a separate note that I take, but the things that are really distinct, I'll use it to mark up my Bible as well. So Matthew chapter 5, starting in verse 1, let's jump right into it. We got a lot of fun stuff that I want to cover tonight. And if you don't have your Bible with you, I've kind of got this screen up here so you can track along with it. So this is the Sermon on the Mount. It says, now when he saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him and he began to teach them. And it says he said this. Now, we need to pause right here because there's a line in here that is so important. It's right here. He went up on a mountainside and sat down. So this is kind of our first clue into what's going on. So the book of Matthew is written by Matthew. Yes, you're correct for 100 points. Congratulations. Way to guess it. Fantastic job. It is written by Matthew. This is what we know of Matthew from the accounts of Scripture. Matthew is a Jewish tax collector who is called by Jesus to be one of his disciples. Matthew is a Jewish tax collector. And so Matthew is kind of like on the fringes of Jewish culture, but he is still personally devoutly Jewish. And so as he walks with Jesus, as he sees Jesus crucified, as he sees Jesus resurrected and encounters with him, and as he remembers Jesus' words and accounts, what he does is he writes this account, but he writes it for a very specific purpose. He writes it for a Jewish audience. Now, this is what Matthew would have seen at the time of his writing. Like, at the time of Matthew's writing, he had already lived through a significant number of the things that happened in the book of Acts. And so one of the things that Matthew would have seen is he would have seen this message of Jesus move from a Jewish-focused group to the entire world, or as they were referred to as the time, from Jews to Gentiles. Gentiles is what the Jews referred to for anyone who wasn't a Jew. So this is what Matthew is doing, is he is writing his account specifically to a Jewish audience, helping them move from a Jewish past to their Gentile future, from their movement of like, you're only Jewish, God is only working through the Jewish people, to God is working through everyone. And we see like hints of this, like Matthew begins his gospel with this thing that we think is so boring, this record of the genealogy of the birth of Jesus. And we read this and we are like bored out of our minds. But for someone who is Jewish, seeing the like the record of from Abraham to David, and from David to Josiah, and then from Josiah to Jesus, like this would have been fascinating to them. Like they would have been pumped to read this of like, because they knew that the Messiah was going to come from the line of David. So Matthew's writing this and he's writing this to his Jewish audience. And this is one of the clues that we get as to what he's doing, is this: he went up on a mountainside and sat down. Now, outside this understanding, those words are just meaningless. Like, okay, so he goes up on a mountainside to sit down. That may not actually be what happened. You go, what? This is what you need to know. is that phrase, went up on a mountainside and sat down, was traditionally a phrase that was only used to describe Moses. And so Moses is the one who the law that the Jews followed came from. Like, God gave it to Moses, you know, Ten Commandments, you remember that. And so God gave it to Moses, but that's how they would describe Moses' teaching throughout the book of Exodus and other pieces. Moses would go up on the mountain. And so when Matthew gives us this clue, we should read it not simply as a physical description that Jesus went up on a mountain and sat down and then everyone listened to him teach. No, what he's actually doing here is he's, for the Jewish people, he's saying what he's teaching should be seen as a further step of the teachings of Moses that you have adhered to your entire life. Isn't that, like, doesn't that geek you out? Like, it just seems like such a throwaway description. Jesus went up on a mountainside and sat down. But for his Jewish audience, what Matthew is doing, they're like, oh my goodness, this matters. Like, this is so important. So, that was like, oh my goodness, I used so much time just to talk about that little piece right there of he went up on a mountainside and sat down. And so I will try to move along a little quicker within this. But let's jump into it. So it says, his disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying, and I'll get into the actual Beatitudes in just a second, but I want you to see something really important. He says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now this phrase, kingdom of heaven, is central to Matthew's account of Jesus' life. Luke uses a similar phrase. He uses the phrase kingdom of God. He means the same thing. And what you'll notice in these Beatitudes, in verse 3 is the first Beatitude. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Verse 10 is the last Beatitude that we have recorded. And it says, blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. I didn't scroll down in time on that. But we see that the Beatitudes are bookended by this phrase, kingdom of heaven. And it's important that we understand what that is. So often we misunderstand Jesus's teachings on heaven because of, I don't have a better way of phrasing it than pop theology. And sometimes we only hold on to the simplest concept to understand and not the most accurate concept to understand. And we need to understand this. Yes, heaven is where you go. Yes, heaven is where you go when you die. As a follower of Christ, heaven is where you go. But what Jesus teaches is that heaven is so much more than that. And so I want to make it with kind of taking some steps over some of the introductory pieces. I want to kind of boil it down to the most pivotal point you can understand. And that is this. The kingdom of heaven is where Jesus is king. Oh, if you're taking notes, that should have been like your cue. The kingdom of heaven is where Jesus is king. Wherever Jesus is king is where the kingdom of heaven is. And so what makes heaven heaven? It's not streets of gold and harp music and whatever other descriptions we have within scripture or people make up in their own heads of what heaven is like. Heaven is heaven because God is there. Heaven is heaven because we are functioning according to the virtue and to the rule of God. That is what makes it heaven. And so the kingdom of heaven is wherever Jesus is king. And so as Jesus teaches about the kingdom of heaven, or if you read the account in Luke, the kingdom of God, you'll see this phrase, the kingdom of heaven is like. The kingdom of heaven is like. Because what Jesus is attempting to do, what Jesus is doing, is he's teaching us this is what it looks like to live in the values and to live in the means of what the kingdom of heaven truly is. The kingdom of heaven is wherever Jesus is king. This is the central teaching. And so there's this piece of it. And the verse is, let me get the verse right. It's Luke chapter 17, verse 21. And Jesus teaches it like this. He says, don't listen to people say, there it is, here it is, here's the kingdom. And then he makes this statement, the kingdom of God is in your midst. And theologians and scholars have used this phrase that is the already, but not yet nature of the kingdom. That when Jesus came, he was in essence inaugurating this new state of the kingdom of heaven, this new reality of the kingdom of heaven in our lives. And it's in our midst. Like you can grasp it, you can feel it, you can sense it, but it's not quite fully here. There's still sin, there's still frustration, there's still problems. Yes, we know there's problems. And we need to understand this as the central teaching, because what Jesus is doing in the Beatitudes is not laying out simply a plan for your life, but he is showing us what the kingdom of heaven lived into looks like, what it looks like for us to live now as citizens of the kingdom of heaven. This already but not yet state, this reality of the kingdom of heaven is where Jesus is king, and you can experience it not fully in the fullest sense because Jesus isn't fully here, but you can experience the kingdom of heaven in your life now. And so if we would, like, instead of just going, oh, this is what each Beatitude is, if we could pull back and go, what is happening right here, what Matthew is recording, is Jesus saying, hey, you have lived by this law for so long, but I want to show you what the law points to. The law doesn't point to right living. The law points to heaven as a present reality, and this is what that looks like. So let's take a look with that note at some of these different beatitudes that Jesus lists out and makes some sense of them. And again, we're just gonna skim the surface. You could spend weeks on each one of these individual teachings. But for us within there, we're just gonna touch the surface a little bit on them. So first one begins with this. He says, blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who aren't fully satisfied with what they have. Blessed are the poor in spirit. That's what that means. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. You cannot receive heaven if what you currently have is all you ever desire. There's this piece on this initial part of Jesus' teaching that if you're going to receive heaven, you need to long for more than what you can tangibly, physically see. Your soul has to have a deeper desire than simply what's in front of you. So he says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn. This is not a statement of blessed are those who are sad. It's a larger statement of, like, blessed are those who mourn of the world at the state that it is currently in. Now, if I was preaching this passage in a typical message, you'd have to, like, tap into that a little bit, and you'd have to go through, like, why should we mourn at the world in the current state that we're in? But we've all been quarantined in our homes for like 2 or 3 weeks, and so there's no confusion in your mind as to why that should happen. So I'm not gonna belabor it. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. The third beatitude, blessed are the meek. And we usually misread this, and we automatically just translate the word meek as mild. And we go, blessed are the mild, for they will inherit the earth. And that seems to throw everyone off, but that's not what's taking place here. And so one of my favorite ways to understand this is that when a horse has been trained, before it's wild, before you can't ride it, before it can't be used for any purposes, but when a horse has been trained, it is referred to as it is now meek. The horse is usable. The horse's strength can be pointed in a direction and accomplish a purpose. That's what Jesus is saying here. Blessed are, another way to translate it, is the humble. Blessed are those who aren't so arrogant that they're just gonna do their own thing anyway, no matter what. Blessed are the meek, not the mild. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed, verse 6. Let me move this down so you can follow along in case if you didn't have your Bible with you. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are those who desire what only God can give, and you will receive what you can only receive for God. Let me pause within this real quick, and we'll continue this in just a second. What you'll notice throughout this is in the New International Version translation, all of these begin with the word blessed.
Blessed.
Every single time it begins with the word blessed. And in some translations, some more modern translations, and sometimes when I hear people refer to this, they switch the word blessed with the word happy. And it like kind of reads nice because blessed isn't a common word that we use. And I'm not saying if your translation of the Bible says happy, you need to go get a new Bible. Like, your Bible's perfectly fine. But on that note, let me tell you why that's such just like a, that's a terrible substitute. And this is on the one hand, is what Jesus is referring to within this is an objective reality. Like, blessed, you are, that's what Jesus is saying. He's saying, you are blessed. If God is telling you you're blessed, there is no room for you to go, no, I'm not. Like, he says, no, you're blessed. Whether you feel it or not, whether you like it or not, whether you want it or not, you are blessed. It's an objective reality. There is no room for argument. Happiness, there's room for argument. Happiness is subjective. Happiness is a feeling. And so when we switch this from blessed to happy, it's a really poor understanding, because what he's saying on blessed is like, this is how the world is. This is how God created it. And switching it to, this is how I feel. And if I could explain why, without having had conversations with the people who made that translation change from blessed to happy, and just as a back note, if you just need this understanding, the reason why we have translations is because the Bible wasn't originally written in English. It was written, the New Testament was written in Greek. The majority of the Old Testament was written in Hebrew. That's why we have this work of translation that we have to do, and the words don't always match up one-to-one. But from my understanding, the reason why people translate it instead of blessed is happy is because, for one, We don't use the word blessed today. That's not common language. We don't talk about, oh, I'm so blessed. And if somebody does it, it's usually in somewhat of a mocking way. And so the word happy was meant to connote this, like, to this stronger feeling that people have, this stronger desire. Because no one says, like, no one really today says, I want to be blessed. They say, I want to be happy. This is why people make the decisions that they do, is because they want to be happy. And so when they're translating it and switching it to happy, they're trying to tap into this more felt emotion of an urge and a longing for happiness. But within that is just this inherent problem is, man, there's something deeply, deeply wrong with our theology, deeply wrong with our understanding of God, if we would prefer happiness over the objective state of being blessed by God. And so, man, I just want to say, like, this is right. Blessed by God are those who are involved, are those who do these things. And so, with that aside, let's continue. So he says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Let me pause right here for just a second. I don't want to take too long on this. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. You could say the inverse of this. Cursed are the unmerciful, for they will not be shown mercy. You go, oh, that is harsh. And it's not this. Jesus doesn't mean this as this like warning. It's this understanding of, if you're unwilling to forgive, it means you're unaware of the reality of what God has done on your behalf. And Jesus, later on, he tells this parable of a man who owed a sum that was so great he could have never repaid it and was forgiven. And then comes across a man who owed him just this really small sum of money, and he throws him into prison because of what he owed him. And it says the man who forgave him the great debt looks at him and throws him into prison. And his understanding is like, you obviously do not realize what I did for you. Otherwise, your heart would be transformed. That's what this beatitude is hitting at. It's saying like, your willingness to forgive others the wrongs that they have committed against you and the offenses that they have committed to you is embedded in your understanding, your mercy to them is embedded in your understanding of the ways in which God is merciful to you. And if you're unwilling to extend mercy, to extend forgiveness to others, what it reveals is not like, oh, you did it wrong. What it reveals is that you have not truly accepted the mercy that God extended on your behalf. Oh, that's good. So he says, blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. You could say it like this. Blessed are those who want to see God. That's what it means to be pure in heart. Blessed, not like, blessed are those who never did anything wrong. That's not what it's saying. Blessed are those who above all want to see God, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the sons of God. They're doing the work of God by extending peace. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. There we have that phrase again, the kingdom of heaven. And so this is what Jesus is doing within this whole section. This is why Jesus is teaching these things. It's not meant for us to like write them down like a checklist, like, oh, got that, oh, got that one. Oh, mercy, need to work on that. Oh, pure in heart, nailed, desire righteousness, I'm good. What he's doing, again, This is Matthew writing down this account. And so there's clues that he's putting in here as to what is taking place. Like he sat on a mountainside to pray. He's showing us a movement from the law as the thing that saves us to an ethic of love. What Matthew is doing, what Jesus is teaching and how Matthew presents it within this case is he's showing us, especially for his Jewish audience, this movement. Because so much of their life was wrapped up in the law and what they understood and what they did right and saying, no, the law doesn't save you. It is the way in which you love those around you. That is what matters most. We could contextualize it like this today for ourselves. You're not, because we just say the law and we go, who cares? Like, right? Like, I don't know really anyone today who honestly believes, well, I did all the right things that the Bible says, so I'm saved. I think that mindset has largely fallen out. Instead, we go, my accomplishments, my significance, my popularity, maybe my good deeds, not as much my purity, but my good deeds. I cared for others. I did more good things than bad things. That's what saves me. And what he's showing us here, what Jesus is teaching, is it's a movement from law to love, but it's not just about the actions that you do. Look at this in the language. You can see this in every single one of these. It says, blessed are. Blessed are. Not they will be blessed. No, blessed are. Blessed are. Are, A-R-E, is this state of where you are right now. He says, you are blessed. And as a result, you are blessed already, kingdom of heaven, already, but not yet. But not yet, for theirs is future tense. Like, you are already blessed, and you're already experiencing some of the reality of that blessing, but not quite fully yet. And in the future, this is what will take place in your life. This word are is so important because it makes it a matter of identity and not behavior. And this is so central to everything within Scripture, but especially to Jesus' teachings, this understanding that your behavior doesn't save you. Your right actions, your rightly spoken words, even, and this is part of why, just honestly, I've typically been resistant to a Bible study just for the sake of studying the Bible, is I've just seen so many people who think the thing that saves them, the thing that God is pleased with, is their deep knowledge of Scripture. And your deep knowledge of Scripture is always meant to point to a life that is dependent upon the love of God. In a life that is lived in fulfillment of the love of God in your actions and in your behaviors and in your approach to everyone else. And so this is a matter of identity. This is who you are at the core. And then this is where it's going to get really fun, okay? So he brings up the kingdom of heaven. and he talks about the kingdom of heaven. And he's showing this move from the law to love for the Pharisees. And he's showing what that looks like in their life. And then in just this, what we title it as the next section, but like Jesus was still teaching. And I think so often when we read our Bibles, like Jesus is literally in the middle of a speech. And then we've got this new heading. And we go, okay, I'm done. And like Jesus is like, I'm still talking. Like I'm still going. And so Jesus is still teaching. Don't stop. Don't stop just because it's a new heading. We're going to have to stop after this, even though Jesus is still teaching just because of time and everything else going on. And I want to hit it next week. But then this is what he says next. Verse 13. Oh, let me just make sure I scroll down within this. So you have access to it if you don't have it. Oh, this is great. This is the best. It says, you are the salt of the earth. You are salt. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again and is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled by men? Question. How does salt lose its saltiness? It is not this like complex chemical reaction. It's just really simple. Like other stuff gets in it, like dirt, maybe other spices, maybe something else that you cooked with. Maybe, I don't know, maybe you just left it out. Like how does salt loses its saltiness? It's really simple. It's no longer salt. It's filled with all this other stuff. He says, you are salt. You are the salt of the earth. And how do you lose that? You just get filled with other stuff. You're no longer filled with love. Maybe you're a little filled with love and a little filled with entitlement and a little filled with ego and a little filled with all these regrets and griefs about your past. That's how you lose your saltiness. And then he restates this phrase in a new metaphor. He says, you are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. So we have this first thing. We have the purpose of salt. No one just eats salt. Like no one just, salt. Like you put salt on something to enhance the flavor of it. Light. No one just stares at light. If you stare at light, you can no longer see anything. Like it doesn't, like the purpose of light is not just to stare at light. The purpose of light is for other things to be able to be seen. And what Jesus is saying, he's saying that's your role. You're salt. You're light. And what Jesus is doing, this is like, it is such nice words. It's nice metaphors. It's decent language. It is an all out assault on any form of religion that is just private. That is what Jesus is doing here. He's saying, you're salt, you're light. And for everyone who goes, oh, my faith is my own. I don't need to share it with anyone else. I don't need to talk about it with anyone else. We're not supposed to talk about politics, which I agree with at times within there, at least on Facebook. But we're not supposed to talk about our faith either. Jesus disagrees with you. Like he does. He disagrees with you. That's what this is. You're salt. You're light. You're a city on a hill. No one lights a lamp and puts it under a bowl. And so what Jesus is saying, he's saying, if you're gonna live into this kingdom of heaven thing, if you're gonna move from this understanding for the religious leaders that the law is what my life was about, and Jesus is saying it's love, or if you're gonna move from this understanding that my accomplishments, my significance, my success, my popularity, my achievements, the achievements of my family, my position in society is what my life is about, he goes, no, it's love. And if you're gonna live into this, this is who you are. This is a matter of your identity. Then you have to be salt. You have to be light. Everything in Matthew points to these closing words in Matthew 28 where he says, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. This is the bet. Two quick notes on salt and light, and then we'll wrap up our time together here. And I've been terrible at checking the comments. I apologize for that. I've both weeks said like, hey, I'm going to check the comments. And then I get into the Bible and I just completely forget. So I'll check out these later. when we're done, and I'll respond to anything within there. Two notes that just may get missed within the translation that sometimes gets off. We translate this word at the start of this. It says you, the full translation of the Greek. Okay, there's two distinctions. It's not as simple as just saying you are the salt of the earth. The first one is this, is it is, the full statement is, it is you who are the salt of the earth. Oh, that's more powerful. When he doesn't just say, you are the light of the world. It's not a casual statement. He says, it is you who are the light of the world. That's what the full reading should actually say. It's in contrast to the Pharisees. He's going, everybody's looking at them. He goes, it is you. It is you that people are dependent upon. This turned less into a Bible study and more into a sermon in this moment. I'd say I apologize, but I don't really. Here's the second piece within there, okay? Is this word, you'll notice this, like we have in our English, like first person singular is I, first person plural is we, like third person singular is he, third person plural is like them. We have, you know this, we have second person singular is you. In our English version, there is no second person plural. Only people from the South who say y'all, they're the only people who have a second person plural. This is second person plural. This is, so like the actual Greek reading of the full thing is, it is y'all who are the salt of the earth. This is embedded in this idea again. You can't do it by yourself. He's saying not you individually are the salt of the earth. Not you individually personally are the light of the world. Yes, it is dependent upon you, but it is y'all. Like every one of you, this body of believers, you are the ones who are the salt of the earth. Combined, together, unified, focused. You are the ones who bring this message to the world. So, this for us, this has kind of been our first part in this. I really think we'll just pick this back up next week, continuing with Matthew chapter 5, verse 17. And I hope you've taken good notes. I hope this has been helpful. If you have any questions, man, comment on them. I'll be checking out YouTube and Facebook Live to follow through within that. Check it back throughout the week. But man, I just want to tell you, man, I hope the Bible speaks to you. I hope as you read the Bible, I hope it doesn't just increase your understanding of Scripture. I hope it deepens your love for God. And I hope some way this investment of time that we have together would do that. So, hey, thanks so much for joining us. It's been great to see you on the Bible study. And we'll see you Sunday for church. Thanks for hanging out with us. We'll see you soon.